Hello and welcome to this video. In this video, we'll be doing question 200, number of islands on LeetCode. This is part of our Blind 75 playlist in which Blind 75 questions. Let's begin. So this question, before I start off, I just want to say that this question is probably one of the most important ones for DFS. It lays the groundwork, the foundation, how we code these DFS functions. So this is a really important question. So this is pay attention to this one. So let's begin. Number of islands. So we're given an m by n 2D grid, which is represented by 1s, which is land, and 0s, which is water, and you want to return the number of islands. And you can do this by basically going to the left, right, up, or down, so basically horizontally or vertically. So basically, if we're given this information here, and we start off by looping through our grid, well, one thing we notice is we always want to loop from an island, right? So we always want to check whether the current position is a 1, because then we know it's an island. We don't really want to check from a 0, right? Because obviously 0 is not an island, so we can't really go from that. Basically, what we want to do is when we do our DFS from the initial 1 position, we want to try to explore all of the areas that are connected to this initial position. And so this basically forms one island. Then when we go to this next position over here, well, we'll note that we actually already visited this as part of this initial DFS call. So we need to keep track of the islands, or not the islands, but the indexes that we visited in the past. And so we'll skip this one. We'll also skip this. We'll actually skip a lot of these. Actually, everything, because this is the only single island on the chart. So this will give us the answer of 1. If we go to the second one here, we'll start off all the way over here at the top left, as we always do. And we'll visit this. And now we can see that these 4 is basically all we can do. And so that forms the first island. Next thing we'll do is we'll try to visit this one as we're looping through our array, but we'll see we actually already visited this from this initial DFS call, so we'll skip this. And in fact, we'll skip all of this until we reach over here, and this one actually has no surrounding boundaries, so this one will make the call number 2. It'll make 2 islands, and then similarly all the way here, when you visit here, we'll visit this one also, and this will make 3 islands. And again, when we visit this fourth one over here, this last one, we'll notice that we actually don't need to DFS on this because it was already taken care of from this position over here. So that kind of just basically tells us like we need to keep a visited array, DFS, we need to keep track of all those things. So this is why I like this question, because it really lays the groundwork on how DFS questions should be approached. So let's just go ahead and code this, and I'll explain some of the key things as I start off. Well, basically, the way I like to do these questions is I like to just keep my variables always named the same. So we'll have the list of rows, or the amount of rows, and we'll have the amount of columns. So this is grid and grid at 0. Then basically, I will loop through my rows, and I will loop through my columns. And basically, what I want to check is if grid at I and j is equal to 0, then we can do our DFS call, right? So here I'll just call my call helper. I'll just call my function helper. And basically, what do I know from this? Well, I know that when I do a DFS call, that's basically equivalent to one island, because my DFS call should visit all of the neighboring ones horizontally and vertically. So basically, all I need to really do is I just need to increment my result variable by 1. So my result variable, I can just start off at 0, and then I increment it by 1, and in the end, I just return result. Okay, so this is basically how we can start off this function. Now, let's just go ahead and do our helper. So this is our DFS helper. So what are some of the variables we'll need? So we'll need self, just because of how the question is coded. Looks like we'll need the grid. We'll need the current position, which is I and j, and that's equal to the row and call. And do we need anything else? Well, let's see. I don't think we need anything just yet, but we will soon. So let's just see. So the first thing I want to actually do is in any DFS call, you want to make sure you're staying inside bounds, right? You want to make sure you don't go outside of the grid. This can obviously happen, like if you're traveling left and right, up and down, you might go outside of the grid. So we need to make sure this doesn't happen. So in order for us to do this, we need to first keep track of the rows and calls. So rows and calls. And this video is going to be more of like an instructional one rather than like us working on it together, because it's one of the most foundational ones on DFS. So I kind of want to lay the groundwork of how I like to code these problems. So it's kind of more instructional in that matter, but hopefully you can still follow along when I'm still explaining well. So basically, we keep track of the rows and calls, right? And so how are some of the ways we can be out of bounds? Well, this is a small like formula I like to follow, and I use this for all of my questions for DFS. But basically, I check. So if a row is less than 0, or row is greater or equal to rows, column is less than 0, or column is greater or equal to number of columns, If this is the case, then we're out of bounds, right? This basically means we're out in terms of the row format. This means we're out because we exceeded the amount of rows. This means we're out because our column is all the way to the left. This means we're out because our column is past the total number of columns. If this is the case, then we know that we're out of bounds and we should just basically return, right, to the caller of whatever the caller is. A second thing we want to check here is basically, let's say that we visited a cell in the past, right? So if we are over here, like let's say we're here, right? We're over here. And let's say we go over here, right? And then this call, there's a call downwards. But we don't want to visit this cell once again, right? Because then it would just be an infinite recursion. So we need to keep track of the cells we visited. So one more thing I'll need here is a visited array, or not a visited array. We can just keep it as a set. We can do like if row call is in visited, so we're just storing the index here. Again, we'll also return, right? So this kind of tells us that we need to add stuff to visited, basically the indices that we visited. So once we have these error checks out of the way, we're basically ready to basically do our DFS. Now, one more thing you might have noticed is we're just considering the ones over here, but it's possible that when we go to the right-hand side, we'll also reach a zero. And if we reach a zero, well, then we can't really handle this, right? This is not part of the island. So we also need to check that place. So we will check if grid at row and call equal to one or is equal to zero, which basically means, I'm sorry, this should be one, by the way, is equal to zero. Then this means that we've reached water. So also we want to return from here. So now that we're done our error checks, now we can basically continue and do the actual DFS call. So before we do the DFS call, I will add to visited the current column and row, current row and column, so we know like we've already visited this in the past. Then I will basically do my DFS call. So here I will do self.helper, and I will just pass in the grid row and visited. And since we need to do this for all four directions, I'll just paste this. And so now I'd just like to do the direction. So left, if you go left, what are we doing? Well, we're decreasing the column by one. If you go right, we're increasing the column by one. If we go up, we're decreasing the row by one. If you go down, we're increasing the row by one, right? And this is basically going to allow us to basically do a DFS across the grid. And if I go back here now, we can fill out what all of these should be. So this is very self-explanatory. This will be grid, it'll be ij, and we need a visited, so let's just create a visited. And as I said, it should be a set. Visited is equal to set over here. And now, this should basically give us a working solution. So let's go ahead and try it out. You can see helper is not defined because I need to do self.helper here. So we can see we actually got the wrong answer here. Let me see where I messed up. I messed up because, yes. But one more thing I actually need to check is I need to make sure visited, even though like when we are doing our DFS call, like when we are doing our DFS call from here and then we go to the right hand side and we potentially go back, right? Even though like we're doing that, we still should check the visited in the main array over here. Because if I consider this one, then when I come back to the main for loop, I don't want to loop again from this area, right? That's going to give me more islands that I have. So I'll do if grid at ij is equal to j and ij not in visited, not in, right? If I do this, should get the right answer and I'll submit and it might work or it might get time limit exceeded. Okay, so it works, but it's not actually the best here. And the reason is because we can actually not use this visited memo altogether. We actually don't need this altogether. And it comes by just looking at this array over here and just noticing that if we, and I'm trying to erase all of this, but basically whenever we are doing a search, right? Whenever we are doing the search, if we go from here and then we go over here, why don't we basically just mark this as a zero after, right? Why are we continuing to keep it one and storing it in the visited? We actually don't really need to do that. Because if you think about this, if we start over here, if we start over here, then we go to the right-hand side over here, and then we go to the left, and then, you know, we go to the right or whatever, right? Then once this is basically done, we can just mark this as a zero. We actually don't need to keep this as a one, because if we mark it as a zero, then any subsequent visits to it will actually just be hit by this condition over here. So we don't need to consider it anymore. So let's just go ahead and do that. So if we do that, then we actually get rid of quite a bit of stuff. So visited, we'll completely remove. We can remove this call here. We can remove all of this actually. So let me remove all of this. And visited, we'll remove this. Or remove this call. And remove this call. But now what we need to do is that when we are done, we'll remove this as well. Basically, when we are doing our DFS call, just before we finish our DFS call, or just before we start our DFS call, I can do grid row at call is equal to 0. So what will this do? Well, this, if I go back here, basically just before this one goes to the right-hand side, I will change this to be a 0. I will change this to be a 0. Sorry, it's getting a little messy, but hopefully you can understand from my voice what I'm trying to say. This will be a 0. So then if I go here and then I try to go back left, well, it's not going to let me, right? Because this is a 0. So then once this is done its DFS call, or once this is starting its DFS call, this will become a 0, etc. So let's go ahead and try this now. And we can see that it works. Now we can just go ahead and press submit. And again, we can see that it works. Now, notice that if we actually put this DFS call all the way at the bottom, it actually won't work. And the reason for this is because if you go to the left, then the first thing we'll want to do is maybe go to the right again, right? If we go to the right here, then if we go to the left, well, if we keep doing these DFS calls, we haven't had time to kind of set this value to be 0 here. So it's very important that this actually stays 0 at the first. It's the first thing we do before our DFS call. Yeah, I just want to end it off at that. Anyway, so what is the time over here? Time and space. So basically, if you think about it, the maximum we're doing is we're DFSing all the way through the grid. So that would be O of M times N. And so that would be O of M times N in terms of the time. In terms of the space, also you can think of space as stack space if you want to think about it. So maximum we are having that many O of M, and also like space constraints as well. But you should maybe just discuss that with your interviewer if you want to consider that, because we aren't actually storing like anything, any external variable. If we had the visited set, then we need to take that into consideration. But since we don't here, we don't really need to take that into consideration. So yeah, this is this problem, and hopefully like this design made sense to you and you can use it in your own problems. All right. Thank you for watching.